Ascent Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Leading with Vulnerability. Unlock your greatest superpower to transform yourself, your team, and your organization. By Jacob Morgan. Narrated by Jacob Morgan. Publisher's note, this audiobook has bonus material. Please contact whomever you purchased this audiobook from to request the material. All figures referenced in this audiobook can be found in the bonus material. To Noah and Naomi, may you always lead with vulnerability, and I will try to do the same. To my wife, Blake, you are simply amazing, and I love you. To my family, thank you for your support and love. And to you, the listener, thank you for starting this book and going on this important journey. Foreword by Dr. Marshall Goldsmith. As an executive coach for over 40 years, my mission has been to help successful leaders get even better for the sake of their companies, teams, and their own lives. Throughout my career, I have observed that one of the most common struggles among smart and talented individuals is their vulnerability. Too often, leaders are hesitant to show vulnerability, fearing that it will be perceived as a sign of weakness. This can lead to a command and control approach that is far less effective than one in which leaders cultivate humility, trust, and vulnerability within their teams. Many leaders understand this important point, but they struggle to find ways to live out this shift in behavior on a daily basis. Leading with Vulnerability offers a practical and proven approach to understanding vulnerability and how to incorporate it into your leadership style. Jacob offers powerful insights and personal revelations on what it means to be a competent, vulnerable leader. He has interviewed top leaders around the world, sharing their experiences and offering listeners a grounded look and how to live out vulnerability amid challenging situations. By providing actionable advice and pulling together these stories, Jacob has created a book that empowers listeners to harness their vulnerability and become the leaders they were meant to be. It's essential for leaders to understand that vulnerability is not a license to share everything about yourself, including your fears and insecurities with your team. Vulnerability should not be a replacement for good leadership, nor should it be an excuse for poor decision-making. In fact, vulnerability should be balanced with good judgment, thoughtful communication, and a clear understanding of what information is appropriate to share with your team. As Leading with Vulnerability highlights, being vulnerable doesn't mean being weak, but rather being confident enough in yourself and your abilities to be honest about your mistakes, limitations, and uncertainties. It's about cultivating a culture of trust, openness, and honesty that enables your team to thrive and your organization to achieve its goals. If you are a leader looking to build better relationships, foster constructive work cultures, and realize the full potential of your team and organization, this is the book you need. It is a timely and important reminder that true strength comes from embracing vulnerability rather than hiding behind a facade of control and power. With its focus on personal growth and development, this book is not just for leaders, but for anyone looking to build better relationships and create a culture of vulnerability and trust within their teams and organization. Dr. Marshall Goldsmith is the Thinkers 50 number one executive coach and a New York Times best-selling author of The Earned Life, Triggers, and What Got You Here Won't Get You There. Introduction. Where it all began. A loud explosion went off. "We have to run now," Clara said. Another barrage of explosions started, and it felt like the world was on fire. Clara grabbed her 4-year-old daughter, Genya, who could barely make sense of what was happening. It was the beginning of World War II. Without having time to grab anything, they ran out into the night along with thousands of other people. As they ran, they saw Zoya, a young girl, Genya's age, who was running around screaming. Her mother had just hung herself after finding out her husband was killed in battle. Clara grabbed Zoya, and all three of them fled. Clara and the two girls came to an open field. They had to cross the field as low-flying fighter pilots dropped bombs on them. There was chaos everywhere, and Clara lost the hand of one of the girls. Faced with the choice of all of them getting killed and saving herself and one little girl, Clara grabbed the other girl and continued on to safety. Eventually, Clara and the other girl got to a train station. The train traveled over a river when another explosion went off, and the bridge the train was on was destroyed. The train and all of the passengers plummeted into the cold, dark water below. They crawled over dead bodies until they emerged from the water and walked and hitchhiked their way to Tbilisi, Georgia, where Clara's sister, Sonia, lived. Clara Taxer, who only had 3 years of formal education, found a job as a waitress. They were desperate to find a place to live, and a woman who was renting a 10-foot by 15-foot room in a complex agreed to let them stay with her. Clara and her daughter rented a corner of the room where all they had was a bed. They lived out of their suitcases, which were kept on the floor. The restrooms and kitchens were all communal. Clara worked double shifts at a restaurant to make a few rubles a month. At night, Clara was harassed by the men who frequented the restaurant. Nobody protected her or stood up for her as the men made passes and grabbed her body. Every night after work, she would come home and cry. Sometimes, Clara would bring home leftovers that other patrons didn't finish so she and her daughter could eat. Genya was alone all day, every day, until late at night. She had nowhere to go, so she would sit in a Catholic church every day because it was safe, even though she was Jewish. Genya became friends with the priest, who told her that if she wanted to keep visiting the church, she should get baptized. So she did, even though she was only 5 and didn't understand what that meant. During World War II, there was a syphilis scare, so the USSR, which Georgia was a part of, mandated that everyone who worked in a restaurant get their blood tested. Clara took her daughter and they went to the home of Alexander Drampov and Nina Igiazarova, an Armenian couple who never had any children. Nina liked Genya so much that she invited her to come over whenever she wanted. Over the years, Alexandra and Nina became Genya's unofficial foster parents because Clara worked so much and was never home. In college, little Genya became fascinated with chess and won a few tournaments. She graduated with a master's degree in history and philology, which is the study of language. One day in college, a friend of Genya's told her she wanted to set her up with someone who worked at the circus, a Jewish cello player named Alex Begelfour. When Genya first met Alex, she didn't really like him or feel connected to him. But as she and her friend were leaving the circus, a few guys started harassing them. At that moment, Alex was also walking out with his cello, and he defended them, then walked the girls home. A few years later, they married and had 2 kids, Ella and Irina. In the late 1970s, Clara, Genya, her husband Alex, and their 2 daughters had to make a tough choice to flee the Republic of Georgia. Under the communist regime, they didn't feel safe or free. This wasn't easy because Alex loved Georgia. He was known in all of the entertainment circles, had lots of friends, and belonged to a huge community. But he wanted a better life for his family. They left Georgia as refugees with no money, no possessions, which were all stolen or confiscated, no legal documents, and without speaking a word of English. The only thing they were able to take out of the country was a few $100s and a half-carat diamond that they snuck out in the handle of a knife. My grandmother still has that diamond in a ring she wears. From Georgia, they went to Italy, which was a transition zone for people leaving Georgia. To make money, they sold tchotchkes at a local flea market, but they barely made enough money to afford eating macaroni and spaghetti for dinner. Genya met a handsome Georgian rugby player while they were both in line at an immigration office. Genya introduced David Mamisashvili to her daughter Ella, and eventually they got married. From Italy, they ended up in Australia, where Alex and his wife Genya worked as cleaners in a chocolate factory. Eventually, Alex became a taxi driver and formed his own string trio, and Genya became a Russian teacher for politicians and officers at a naval academy. Ella and David had 2 sons, Jacob, me, and my brother Joshua. Clara was my great-grandmother. Genya is my grandmother. Alex was my grandfather, and Ella and David are my parents. To this day, my grandmother doesn't know if she is Genya or Zoya. Clara never told her which girl was lost during the bombings in Ukraine. When I was young, my parents relocated to the United States. My dad was obsessed with the American dream. He changed his last name to Morgan to sound more American because nobody was able to pronounce his real last name, Mamisashvili, over the company loudspeakers. He moved to the United States first to set up a life before my mom and I joined him from Australia. For several years, my mom and dad communicated with each other by sending letters in the mail. He learned to speak English by watching the Johnny Carson and Merv Griffin shows with an English to Russian translation dictionary that I still have today. He would spend hours each day looking in the mirror and trying to mouth out English words properly while he lived in low-income housing in New Jersey. My dad's mom was Sarah Bagdadishvili, a stay-at-home mom, and his dad was Yasha Mamisashvili, a store clerk. I never met Sarah, but I did meet Yasha once when he came to Los Angeles when I was very young. Coming from communism, where everything belonged to the government, Yasha couldn't believe that his son, my dad, was able to create a good life for himself. He thought that my mom and I were actors pretending to be his family and that the house and all of his possessions were owned by the government. My dad showed Yasha an old home video to which he replied, "My God, they found me." He believed he was being monitored and followed while in America. Eventually, my dad convinced him of the truth. Yasha passed away a few weeks after his visit due to cancer. He just wanted to make sure that his son was happy and was able to make a life for himself. Although my dad doesn't talk about his past, he will, on very rare occasions, share a story with me, like the time he went from Georgia to Czechoslovakia as a 21-year-old foreign exchange student. A group of students from Georgia traveled with a chaperone who would keep an eye on their every move. My dad loved classic rock, and one day, while he was exploring Czechoslovakia, he picked up a Jimi Hendrix poster. One of the other students on the trip ratted out my dad to get the poster confiscated. To avoid getting in trouble, when my dad was confronted about the poster, he said it was actually of Angela Davis, an American member and supporter of the Communist Party. My dad was lauded for his apparent dedication to communism and was allowed to keep the poster. My dad just retired from the corporate world after working for decades as an aerospace engineer, where he commuted an hour and a half to and from work each day. During COVID, he worked from home. My dad sometimes still makes the commute just to play soccer with some of his coworkers. He's 73. My mom is one of the top marriage and family therapists in Los Angeles, and they live 15 minutes away from me. When you've had to survive like my family, there is no room for weakness. You have to be strong and tough. My mom has always been open and encouraging of vulnerability and emotion, but ultimately, I grew up watching and emulating my dad, who doesn't believe in a trophy for second place. I remember one time after a soccer tournament, my dad and I drove to the coach's house to pick something up. I must have been about 10 years old. We knocked on the coach's door, and he handed my dad and me a trophy. My dad looked at the coach and said, "What is this trophy for? They came in last place." The coach said that they were giving out participation trophies so kids wouldn't feel left out. My dad chuckled and said, "That's bullshit. You can keep the trophy." And we got in the car and left. This was an important life lesson for me, and it taught me the importance and value of hard work. Life doesn't give participation trophies, and it doesn't care about your problems. My dad always told me that the world is a jungle, and that as a man, you always need to be strong and highly competent. Never show weakness under any circumstance. Nobody cares about your problems, so don't share them. And always be good at what you do, or more specifically, try to be the best at what you do. I only ever saw my dad cry once, when he was almost killed. As a pedestrian, he was struck by a car traveling 45 miles per hour. He lay on the ground, covered in blood, screaming. He doesn't remember that, but I do. My father is a good man. He has a lot of integrity, and as he's gotten older, he has become gentle. I see it when he spends time with my kids. He was always there for me and is a good dad, but the model I had growing up was a tough guy off the Eastern Bloc. Physical and mental fitness were number one. That is what I learned. Don't ever show anyone your emotions, and don't talk much. Even today, when I visit my parents' house, he asks me, "Jacob, how many push-ups can you do?" That's how I grew up, not being vulnerable, always needing to be strong, and not showing weakness. Perhaps you grew up hearing similar messages, especially if you are a male. As the stress mounted in my family with two children, one born during COVID, the lack of vulnerability was no longer working for me in my personal life. My wife and I would argue more frequently, it was hard to connect with friends, and my personal and professional relationships didn't feel stable. I didn't quite know how to navigate all of the curveballs life was throwing at me, but I wouldn't admit anything was wrong, and I'd never ask for help. I just kept powering through life. I also noticed many other people were struggling with vulnerability, especially at work. Similar to you, I had heard of vulnerability and had an idea of what it was, but was it really that simple? I felt that most of what I was reading and seeing made it sound like if you just share your weaknesses and challenges, then your problems will go away. Perhaps that's a decent solution in your personal life, but what about at work, which has a completely different dynamic? At work, you have a hierarchy, employees, leaders, deadlines, and the issue of pay. I wondered, can vulnerability really be a powerful way to effectively lead through change? You're probably a current or aspiring leader who is seeing how the world around you is changing, and you're asking yourself, how do I lead through this change? You understand that connecting with people and being able to influence change is one of the most important aspects of leadership, yet you also understand that you need to demonstrate that you are highly capable of doing your job as a contributor to a team and organization. You know what it means to be vulnerable because you have experienced it. But similar to many leaders around the world, you're probably wondering if you should be vulnerable at work, why, what the impact is, and how to do it. You're likely asking the same questions that other leaders are asking. What does leading with vulnerability mean, and how do I do it? What's the impact of leading with vulnerability? What happens if I'm vulnerable and it gets used against me? What are the other attributes that I need to have that help unlock the power of vulnerability? How does vulnerability help me lead through change? Are there examples, stories, and research about vulnerability and leadership? I wanted to answer all of these questions and more because if leaders like you can be vulnerable, then others will follow in your footsteps. This will create organizations focused on growth, development, innovation, and above all, being human. Life is too short to put up a facade of perfection. I've come to understand the power and value of vulnerability. However, at work, vulnerability alone will only get you so far. You need leadership, specifically competence. The relationship between vulnerability and competence is an important one to call out. I cannot stress enough that vulnerability cannot be used as a crutch to justify ongoing poor performance, which is something that is unfortunately happening in many organizations. One of the toughest challenges that leaders are faced with is a pervasive mentality of victimhood. The idea that you can substitute for competence and replace it by pointing out all of the reasons for you not having your required level of competency. Anne Mukherjee is the chairwoman and CEO of Pernod Ricard North America, which has about 1,900 employees. She was born in India and moved to Chicago when she was 5 years old. When she was 14 years old, her mother was killed by a drunk driver, and earlier in her life, she was the victim of sexual assault by someone who was drunk. You might wonder why someone would want to work for an alcohol company after having such tragic experiences with alcohol. For Anne, it's about using those tragic experiences to make things better for other people. Anne doesn't see herself as a victim, but as a powerful change agent who can positively affect the lives of others. She uses her tragedy as fuel for growth and progress. According to Anne, as a leader, if you're not comfortable with your own chaos and adversity, then you're going to falter. You have to get over your own issues and build resilience as opposed to feeling like a victim, which is one of the dangers facing the workforce today. Turn your pain, fear, and weakness into positive power. Being vulnerable allows you to connect with others to build that resilience, but being a vulnerable leader allows you to take that connection and resiliency and do something positive with it to change the world. Be an owner and take your professional development into your own hands. Don't wait for someone to save you. Become your own superhero. Perhaps this is my tough love, immigrant family upbringing speaking, but it's something I have come to believe and something I have observed from successful CEOs I interviewed, many of whom came from troubled, impoverished, and broken families who had to rely on their high levels of competence to get to where they are. Competence is crucial, but it's the combination of vulnerability and competence that truly leads to meaningful and significant outcomes. Vulnerable leaders have both. I believe that the single most important and impactful thing that you can do for yourself and everyone around you is to lead with vulnerability. With that, let's begin our vulnerable leader journey together. Are you ready? Part 1. Who is a weak? No, scratch that. Who is a vulnerable leader? Chapter 1. Panic. On Thursday, December 23rd, 2021, a few weeks after signing the contract for this book, I was standing in my bathroom brushing my teeth and I started feeling weird. My body was flooded with adrenaline, my vision became blurry, and my heart started beating out of my chest. My resting heart rate is usually around 57 beats per minute, and just standing, I was about 130 beats per minute, which is the equivalent of a moderate cardio workout. I thought, this is it. I'm having a heart attack, and I'm going to die. And I was overcome with fear and dread. I felt like a tidal wave of terror just crashed over me. I screamed for my wife, Blake, who was wrangling our kids for school, and I told her something was wrong with me. I laid down on the bed, and then all of a sudden, I started shaking uncontrollably. If you've ever seen the Pixar movie Inside Out, in which emotions are personified by little characters who live in your body, that's what I felt like. As if there were little creatures who were just pushing all sorts of buttons inside of my body, and I had no control. It was absolutely terrifying and the most scared I've ever been. What the fuck is happening to me? Was all I could think about, followed closely by, is this the end for me? The next few days were really rough because I wasn't able to hear back from my doctor and I had no idea what was happening to me. Was I actually dying? Was it all in my head? Not knowing was the worst part. Things calmed down for a few days until it happened again. I asked Blake to drive me to urgent care, which turned me down because they were at capacity with COVID patients. Instead, they gave me the address of a hospital with an emergency room. I forced Blake to drive me there and almost checked myself in, but Blake talked me out of it. Finally, the next day, I was able to get an appointment with a doctor. They reviewed my lab results and did an EKG, and the result was that I'm perfectly healthy and my heart is great. Phew, I thought. Now that I know that, I won't ever have another panic attack again. I just needed a doctor to tell me that I was fine. Or so I thought. Sure enough, a few days later, as I was sitting in my kitchen eating a sandwich, it happened again. What the fuck? The doctor told me I was fine. What could possibly be causing this? I'm not a vulnerable person, and the only human being I know who is less vulnerable than me is my dad. He's the kind of person who could be sick as a dog, and if you ask him how he's doing, he'll say, great. When my dad was struck by a car, he spent many weeks in the hospital recovering. I was young when it happened, and one time I went to visit him where he lay in almost a full body cast. I was feeding him ice chips, which gradually melted in his mouth, because he wasn't even able to drink water. He yelled at me and told me he didn't need my help. He doesn't believe in showing weakness of any kind. I have Georgian immigrant parents, and the Georgian culture isn't exactly known for being vulnerable or emotional. I rarely express my emotions or feelings, and even have a hard time doing this with family. The phrase, I feel, is very foreign to me, but I'm pretty good at saying, I think, or I know. As I've come to learn after speaking with therapists and researching panic and anxiety, your body can only handle so much stuffing down of emotions and feelings. Eventually, there's no more space left in your body, and the physical symptoms begin. A rapid heartbeat, uncontrollable shaking, adrenaline spikes, fear of doom, fever, blurry vision, and the like. Imagine you have a suitcase you are packing with clothes. Eventually, the suitcase fills up, but you keep cramming more clothes in there until you realize there is no way it's going to close. So what do? You sit on the suitcase, and then you force the zipper around it. It shuts for a few minutes, and then all of a sudden, the seam rips and the suitcase flies open. Stuffing down emotions and feelings is the same thing. If you try to keep things in, eventually the mind and the body will win. I learned this the hard way. After diving deeper into what could have caused my panic attacks, it became more clear what a large contributing factor was. This book! The very fact that I had committed to writing a book about vulnerability, something that goes against my very nature, gave me a panic attack. My mind and body just couldn't come to grips with the fact that I was going to have to confront, explore, and dive deep into something I have always stayed away from. My wife Blake told me that by writing this book, I'd be going on a personal and emotional journey to discover more of myself and what it means to be a vulnerable leader. And she was right. I'm on this journey with each and every one of you listening to this book. This is the most important and hardest book I've written, And it's precisely because it explores such a difficult and foreign topic to me and to many others, vulnerability. During the week or so where I thought I was going to die, I became very vulnerable with friends and family. I cried in my mom's arms, told my friends I was struggling, and had to explain to my kids why I was having a tough time. I saw the deeper connections I was able to make from openly expressing what was happening, the support people gave me, and the candid conversations I was able to have. In one of my team meetings, I shared what I was going through and asked if anyone else had experienced something similar. On my team of 12, 4 others had experienced panic attacks. We were able to come together to talk about this and support each other. I realized how powerful vulnerability could be in both personal and professional environments when done in the right way. In my last book, The Future Leader, the theme of vulnerability came up quite a bit, and I remembered all of those discussions and conversations I had with CEOs and leaders who shared the importance of connecting with people and creating meaningful relationships, yet also needing to focus on business performance. In that book, the skill of YODA, emotional intelligence, including empathy and self-awareness, was the skill that leaders struggled with the most, as ranked by employees who reported to them. I also remembered the specific concerns, issues, and questions that leaders had when it came to vulnerability in the workplace. Thoughts such as being vulnerable without being perceived as weak, how to actually be vulnerable in the right way, why vulnerability alone isn't enough, and what happens when vulnerability isn't received well, and many others. I knew this was a book I had to write because I saw how I struggled with vulnerability and the impact it had on my life and those around me. During my career, I've worked with and interviewed more than 2,000 CEOs and business leaders around the world, and I've also seen how much they struggle with vulnerability. Leading with vulnerability is the single most impactful thing you can do to create connection, drive trust, unlock the potential of those around you, and drive performance, if you know the right way to approach it. That's the key, the right way to approach it. This is a book about you and how you can be a leader who creates trust, connects with your people, unlocks the potential of those around you, and drives business performance. I embarked on the most in-depth and comprehensive project on vulnerability and leadership that's ever been done. For over 2 years, I interviewed over 100 CEOs around the world from different industries, including American Airlines, SAP, Hyatt, Northrop Grumman, Dow Chemical, The Home Depot, and dozens of others. Although only 10% of the Fortune 500 CEOs are women, I'm proud that more than 25% of the CEOs I interviewed for this book are women. These interviews were done in hour-long discussions and follow-up interviews with a small group of CEOs opting to send in responses via email. I also interviewed the world's leading psychologists and researchers spanning a variety of fields, including emotional intelligence, decision-making, trust, psychological safety, game theory, and organizational behavior. This book sets itself apart by offering a unique perspective on the power of vulnerability for leaders, a topic not commonly addressed in business education or corporate environments. To gain a deeper understanding, I sought out insights from CEOs recognizing their paramount responsibility, accountability, and impact on the business world. Some of the questions I asked these CEOs included, but are not limited to, the following. What does being a vulnerable leader or leading with vulnerability mean to you? What does vulnerability feel like in your body? What makes you feel most vulnerable and why? What are other attributes or characteristics that leaders need to have which help unlock the power of vulnerability? How can you be vulnerable at work without being perceived as weak? Have you ever been vulnerable at work and had it used against you? When you're vulnerable, what is your default defense mechanism? What's the impact of being a vulnerable leader? Can you be too vulnerable at work? How do your personal values influence your willingness to be vulnerable? Do you think about the intention or purpose behind being vulnerable? What kind of vulnerable leader are you? And what happens if you work with people who don't believe in being vulnerable? My discussions with these CEOs were extremely in-depth and personal. So much so that several of them requested to be made anonymous in the book. They shared stories and insights with me that they have never shared before. I am grateful for their openness, transparency, and willingness to be vulnerable with me. I laughed and cried with them. I shared all sorts of emotions and in-the-moment discoveries that I will forever be grateful for. Last, I teamed up with global leadership firm DDI to survey almost 14,000 employees around the world, representing more than 1,500 organizations, 50 countries, and 24 major industry sectors. This was done as a part of their Global Leadership Forecast series, which is the longest-running global study of leadership aimed at understanding current and future leadership best practices. We also did a follow-up pulse survey with an additional 1,200 participants. Bringing all of these different perspectives and data points together yielded some truly fascinating insights about leading with vulnerability that I can't wait to share with you. This book will help you understand what it means to lead with vulnerability, why it's so crucial to your success, to your team's success, and your organization's success, and how to actually unlock this amazing superpower for yourself and those around you. Although the strategies and approaches you will learn about in this book are specifically focused on leadership at work, they can also be applied with positive impact outside of work as well. The first section of the book introduces what leading with vulnerability means and the crucial difference between vulnerability and vulnerable leadership. You will learn the three truths of vulnerable leaders and how vulnerability saved the lives of some of the toughest men on the planet working on an oil rig. You will discover why you should lead with vulnerability, the importance of being able to identify emotions, why leaders need to have thick skin and not armor, and the three paths people take to becoming vulnerable leaders. The second section explores why we don't have more vulnerable leaders and what to do about it. You'll hear about the common leadership stereotypes still alive in our organizations today and how to break them, what to learn from working with vulnerable and non-vulnerable leaders, and the importance of using vulnerability early in your career. In the third section of this book, you'll learn about what makes leaders feel vulnerable and why, including the 10 vulnerability signs and what to do if you spot them. You'll also learn how a bank robber used lemon juice to try to avoid being detected on camera and how that affects our perception of vulnerability, why being a gymnast is more stressful than being a sprinter, and why we're all gymnasts, the simple technique you can use when being vulnerable doesn't go as planned, and what we got wrong about the famous Milgram experiment. The fourth section covers what happens to you physically and emotionally when you are vulnerable and why our perceptions of vulnerability change depending on if we are thinking about ourselves or others. You'll learn the common defense mechanisms we use when feeling vulnerable and how to get past them. The three critical moments leaders face when they are confronted with being vulnerable and how to respond when someone is vulnerable with you. The fifth and final section of the book shows you how to lead with vulnerability and unlock your superpower. You'll learn about the five types of vulnerable leader superheroes, the eight attributes of vulnerable leaders, the framework that will help make sure that when you're vulnerable, you will see the highest chances of a positive outcome, when being vulnerable is not a good thing, and how to create and climb your vulnerability mountain. Each section of the book is filled with hard data and stories from the more than 100 CEOs I interviewed to back up and support everything you hear. As a current or aspiring leader, I want you to know that vulnerability is not a weakness. It's a superpower that will transform your life, your team, your company, and the lives of those around you. Being able to lead through change is one of the toughest challenges facing most organizations around the world, and it's not possible to conquer this challenge without vulnerability. In a rapidly changing environment, it's crucial to innovate, work differently, and challenge the status quo. Being able to lead through change is all about people and vulnerability and what creates trust, connection, alignment, growth, and powerful relationships. When these things exist, then people will show up with their best ideas for new opportunities and solutions for tackling complex problems. Discretionary effort will be unlocked so that customers can be served better and employees will feel a greater sense of purpose and meaning. Change is hard and uncomfortable, which is why it's so crucial for leaders to bring people together to go through that change as a team and as an organization. These things are all foundational for leading, especially during times of great uncertainty when the path and the outcome are not known. Leadership is not about hiding behind a mask of invincibility. It's about embracing vulnerability. Unfortunately, most of the leaders around the world don't know that this is a superpower and how to unlock it. When asked if vulnerability is perceived as a leadership strength, not a weakness, inside of their organizations. Less than 11% of people responded with definitely true. And 34% said they were uncertain, which is the equivalent of responding to the question with a response of definitely false. Because if you're uncertain about it, you're likely not going to be vulnerable. This book will give you the research, the tools, and inspirational and transformational stories from the world's top CEOs so that you can lead with vulnerability. Billions of people around the world are walking and talking superheroes, and they don't even know it. This is a completely new way to approach being a leader, one that we have all been scared of and didn't feel comfortable talking about. Going forward, this is the only way to lead. Are you ready to lead with vulnerability? Chapter 2, The Vulnerable Leader Equation. On August 20th, 1991, Hollis Harris, then CEO of Continental Airlines, told his 42,000 employees to pray for the future of the company. In his memo to employees, he said, "We are in a battle here at Continental. We are at war with forces within the company and outside the company." As Doug Parker, the chairman and former CEO of American Airlines, told me, "This is being vulnerable, but it's not being a leader." The next day, Hollis was fired. If Hollis was a junior employee who worked in accounting, then those statements would have had minimal impact. Some employees may have taken notice, maybe some would have taken him out to lunch to ask him why he's having a bad day, and he would have received some words of encouragement and support from his leader, and life would have moved on. When you're a leader, the things you say and do carry more weight and have more impact. Doug had to go through his fair share of challenges as the CEO of American Airlines, including going before Congress and the world to ask for money and support to keep the company from going bankrupt during the pandemic. There were many times he found himself in the parking lot of his company, pumping himself up before heading into work and actually trying to suppress his vulnerability. He told me, "As a leader, the last thing the company needs is for anyone to think or believe that American Airlines is in trouble. Especially during the pandemic, everyone was reading about how our industry was going down, and the last thing I needed was for my team to think or believe any of that because I didn't believe it. Showing up to work panicked and emotional would not have been the right kind of leadership. I believe vulnerability is a strength, but the leadership component has to be there as well because behaving in a way that scares your people is not a good thing for a leader to do." I heard countless stories like this from CEOs who, during the pandemic, had to stand on the front lines with optimism, courage, vision, and above all, leadership. Another such leader is Fleetwood Grobler, the president and CEO of Sasol Limited, a South African energy and chemical company with more than 28,000 employees. He told me the following. "I took over as CEO when the company was in very deep trouble, with over $13 billion in debt. I was working in Lake Charles, Louisiana, finishing a project when I was told by the chairman in early October of 2019 that the team wanted me to come back and be CEO by the end of October. They asked me to deliver the financial results, which I did for the first time in my life. This was at the end of 2019, and then a few months later, in 2020, the pandemic happened. Our company suffered to the point where the banks almost came in and took over because our cash lines and credit flow was up and we were on the hook for $10 billion. In my first town hall, I told the company that I didn't know the answers, but I knew we had a great team and that I could get us back on track. I told them that together we would find a way by rebuilding trust with our team and customers." Great leadership is built on vulnerability, and it enables you to unlock your people's true ability. It creates trust, builds meaningful professional and personal relationships, unlocks new opportunities, mitigates any threats, and transforms you, your team, and your company for the better. Whether you lead a company, a department, a team, a community, your family, or yourself, you are a leader. With this title comes the responsibility to lead with vulnerability. By 2030, we are going to have between 90 million and 440 million leaders around the world. If we take a number in the middle of these two, that's 265 million leaders. These are people who are responsible for the lives of others, for shaping culture and society, creating jobs, speaking up for injustices, and fighting for social causes. True change comes from true leadership. The leaders who embrace vulnerability are the ones who can change the world and guide us to a better future. We cannot create organizational and global change if we don't have the right people to lead us in making that change happen. Jonathan Perchik is the CEO of Travel Centers of America. With almost 19,000 employees, he has focused on building vulnerability into the culture of the company. Here's what Jonathan told me. Failure is built into how our company operates and innovates, which means that vulnerability is built into our culture, and that is a conscious effort. As an example, we may test out 5 or 6 different ideas in an area of our business, knowing that most are likely to fail, but one may give rise to success. We go into this process anticipating failure, mistakes, and challenges. Without vulnerability, there would be no innovation or ability to lead through change, because nobody would feel safe to take risks, to think big, or to even talk about their failures. When I came into this role, the company was performing very poorly, and the stock was under $9. And today, our stock is the highest it's been in 15 years. There is no innovation without leading with vulnerability. It's not easy, it's not comfortable, and it's the only way to lead. Leadership used to be thought of as this nice, cushy job, where you got a huge salary, fancy corner office, special parking spot, and more power. Once you became a leader, you made it. You could just coast for the rest of your career and tell other people what to do. The reality is that when you become a leader, your job becomes much harder, not easier. Great leaders give a part of themselves to their teams and their company. Simply put, they care more and they do more because that is the role they signed up for. See figure 2.1 in the accompanying bonus PDF. Frank Blake is the former CEO of the Home Depot. When he left, the company had more than 350,000 employees, and today it has more than 500,000. As CEO, every Sunday, he spent half his day writing 200 handwritten cards to his team members. He would give the card to the team members, take a selfie with them, and tell them he would hang the picture in his office. If they ever came to Atlanta, they were invited to see their picture in the CEO's office, which many team members and their families did. Here's what he told me when we spoke. As a leader, your people are going to want a piece of you. Every leader is different in how they want to give away a piece of themselves, but that's your job, your responsibility, and your privilege. It could be time, a gesture, or a simple act of recognition. When I grew up, I collected baseball cards, and the easiest signatures to get were always from the outfielders. Nobody really paid much attention to them, and their signatures were easy to get. But when you got their signature, you started rooting for them. Leaders need to do the same thing by saying, "I'm giving you a piece of me." Many leaders don't realize that their job is tough and that they are supposed to give more of themselves than anyone else. Leaders inspire teams, develop a vision and plan, and get people to move in the direction of the vision. Leaders are also responsible for people, organizational resources, creating new products and services, and should be accountable for achieving the goals of the business.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.